Rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in the sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. So I was talking to somebody yesterday about hope, and they were like, it's better not to have hope if it's false hope. And I'm like, hope is something. No hope is nothing. Sure. It's better to have hope, even if it doesn't turn out the way you want it to be, it's still better to have hope, because then you have something. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Now let's go over to that sentence. because we're revealing the secret sister, who your secret sister is.
I gotta say something about that. They changed my appointment to my surgery for the 7th, and our secret sister is the 9th.
Oh, yeah.
So I didn't know if one of the ladies, if the ladies wanted to do it a different day, or a different weekend.
You want to do it without you?
Do it without me?
No.
No, we don't want to do it without you.
You know, we could always change it to like the 4th Saturday instead.
Okay.
Or the 4th Saturday.
But we'll have to look at the calendar. Okay, the women's breakfast is going to be sometime in March. I'm not sure when. What? It's on.
It's not working.
Well, it says, well, they didn't tell me I turned on twice. Anyways.
I can hear you.
Yes?
The Matthew breakfast is this Saturday.
Yes.
Christmas.
Yes.
Yes.
I believe that's what it says up there on the men's breakfast thing. First Saturday. It's the first Saturday of each month, and it's at the Christmas. This week. This week. This week. Right? Okay. It's at
8:30.
Okay. Pencil just broke. Okay. Back to the women's breakfast. Sometime in March. We're having a women's breakfast. We will let everybody know. We can put a notice on Facebook. And we will have a secret sister reveal. So, thank you.
You're saving me.
Okay, and that is sometime in March. And then on the 21st, the Family Resource Gala, the dinner. I went to it last year was the first one I went to, and it was really good. So, if you can make it there, to go and support them. There's a sign-up sheet out in the fellowship hall. We'd like to know how many people are coming because the church is going to buy tickets. We're going to... We're going to pay for one table, and if we have more people that want to come, we'll pay for another one. So, Palm Sunday, Easter's coming. Easter's coming really quickly. So, Palm Sunday... We have a giveaway where we go to the corners. We have three corners over there. And we give out palms to anybody that goes through that is willing to take them. And that will be on the 24th of March. On the 29th of March, and that will be right after the service. On the 29th of March at 6 p.m., we're going to have the Good Supper, which we did for the first time last year. We're just going to celebrate... you know, Jesus' last days. It's just going to be a simple, very simple, maybe just a soup and bread, water. But it was very powerful. Last year when we came out, I think we must have had 12, 15 people or something like that, and it was very powerful. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, we have our sunrise service at 6:30. At 7:30, we'll have our pancake breakfast, and then we'll have our 10 a.m. service following the breakfast. So, it would be really great if everybody could be there because it's a really good time in the Lord. Anybody else have any announcements they want to make? Nope. Okay. Well, Pastor Greg is going to, Pastor Andrew is not here again, as you all can see, but we have a wonderful brother in the Lord, Bob, who is going to share the word with us today. But right now, Pastor Greg, the wonderful prayer warrior that he is going to pray for us.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Let's bow our heads. Everlasting Father, our God, thank you this morning for another opportunity to gather together with the family of God, our brothers and sisters here at Mallory. Thank you for the beautiful sunshine and just great time of year, Lord, as we anticipate not only a new season just around the corner as fall is almost upon us, hallelujah, but we also anticipate your blessings this morning. So take what we have to bring before you this morning, and by your mercy and grace, bless this congregation, bless this service in every way. And we think of our pastor and his family this morning, and we pray for healing and help for them, as I'm sure they would appreciate that. So, Lord, bless this time. And bless each one that you've led to this place. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand as we continue with our worship today.
Thank you. Father, thank you for this opportunity to continue to worship you in a manner that's very important because it centers on you. These things that we do are meant to be used by you because they're done for you. Not to gain salvation, but to put it forth, to bring it to other people. Help us, God, to administer these things correctly.
I'm the earth and I'm good.
Dismiss the children this morning for Children's Church, ages 3 to 11. Opportunity this morning for prayers, praises, and prayer requests. But before we do that, I noticed this morning the February memory verse once again. Memory verse that's in your bulletin every week for that particular month. This month it's from Ephesians 3:20, but I was looking in the scriptures this morning. And the whole end of that chapter, chapter 3 of Ephesians, Paul writes to the church. The title above that section is A Prayer for the Ephesians, and we could just as easily substitute the word A Prayer for Mallory. So let me read those few verses with you this morning. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning with verse 14. And let's, as we read the scriptures, let's apply what Paul writes to the church here in this place. He says this: For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family, that's us, in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all of the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God.
Amen.
Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. As we lift up praises and prayers this morning to our Lord, I'd like to do it a little bit differently this morning, only because this pastor is wearing two hearing aids, and sometimes, especially in the back, I don't hear what the prayer requests are. It's hard to hear and write those things down unless I actually walk back and stood there with you. So what I'd like to do this morning, I'll open in prayer. After we share some praises, I'll open in prayer, and then I will be quiet. I'm sure there's some hallelujahs here for that. You know, this is a long-lived pastor. So I'll be quiet, and I'll allow you to pray. If you have prayer requests this morning specifically, I invite you to lift those up in the congregation, either silently in your heart, God hears those prayers, or openly, so that all that are here can hear that. And when the congregation, when the sanctuary grows quiet, I will close in prayer. Can we do it that way this morning?
Yes.
I'd be glad for that.
Yes.
All right, let's share first of all some praises. You can do that out loud, and I see a hand way in the back, Sherry, nice and loud. How about a praise?
I have praise God. We have a new great granddaughter. It's my son's third grandchild. My name's off my head. Madeline Rose.
Oh, wow.
6 pounds, 11 ounces. Grandkid. I guess this time it was harder. First two were really easy, but this time it was hard. They live in Maine, but mom and baby are doing well.
All right, great praise. Grandchildren are a great blessing.
Yes.
Especially when you can send them home to mom. Marty and I were there, so we'll speak from firsthand experience. Other praise, yes, Carly.
Pastor, this morning I would like to praise God for the sunshine.
Yes.
The fact that we have vehicles to get here.
Yeah.
We have padded pews to sit in. Mm-hmm. We have heat. Mm-hmm. Most of all, we have him.
That's right. Yeah. That's the most important thing. Amen. Thank you. Good praise. Some others.
Yeah.
I'd like to praise God for two men that I met on our trip to Connecticut at Rochester over the last week. One's name is Frank. He works hard at Walmart. Getting the carts, and he had trouble with a tooth that he was recovering from surgery when I met him, and he was very outspoken and very forward in wanting to tell me about that. Another one is a young man, I don't know what his name is, but in Rochester, on Saturday, Friday, we had an accident where he was driving a pickup truck, and he couldn't stop and hit us in the tail end. I told them I'd pray for them. They were just joys to be with. I think they made things a lot easier. And Frank and unnamed truck driver,
praise the Lord for those people that we meet daily, here, there, and everywhere, and especially the blessings that go along with that. Other praises. Yes.
I have praise of my granddaughter and son, and Sandra came to dinner last night, so we were able to visit with them. So I'm just thankful for that. As usual, Tara was her great self.
but to spend time with family.
And I didn't want to send her home.
In whatever way that unfolds.
Right.
It's good to spend time with family and loved ones, friends and neighbors. Don't stop doing that. I mean, reach out. If you're missing family and thinking about them, get on the phone or pay a visit and spend time with family. Time goes fast, and before you know it, you miss the opportunity to do those things. So even today, this afternoon, if you have no other plans, think of a family member. Make a phone call. We're here for dinner or whatever, or I'll come over there for dinner. That works too. Just spend time with your loved ones. That's a blessing from God. Other praises. I praise the Lord that we've got sound people and people that can manage this and manage that. I don't know if you noticed when you came in, Don has that special picture. I commented on it last week, and it just blessed my heart. It reminded me of so many opportunities. There it is. It reminded me of so many opportunities that I've had to enjoy God's creation. And, you know, if you've been in the woods or the mountains or the lakes, maybe you've seen that picture with the mist and just the beauty of God's creation. So that's certainly worthy of praise. Don, thank you for finding that for us. Other praises. Yes, Terry.
That picture is beautiful, but I'm glad I'm not there.
We almost are, brother. We almost are this morning with the sunshine and the beautiful sky and the clouds and the mist. I'm sure you can. That takes you someplace in your life, that a place that you've enjoyed, whether it's been a camp or a vacation. God's creation is glorious. Yes. Oh, you didn't raise your hand?
No.
Oh, I saw your hand.
It did, but not up.
Yes.
In this last couple weeks, I've been able to reconnect with a family friend in body. While she was passing to glory, and we had her funeral on Sunday. And it was revisiting my childhood. So you saying, you know, make sure you take the opportunity to connect and reconnect with those. It was good for all that came together because we all grew up together. You know, we shared children together. We a lot of good memories, and it's part of how we became who we are. And so I give God glory that he gave me that opportunity to reconnect with some of those folks that I haven't seen maybe in 25 years or more.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so, but it's just a homecoming. You know, you walk in the room and it's as if no time has passed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it was good. It was good to grieve together. It was good to reminisce and to remind ourselves the goodness of that life. Of someone we love so much, and the thing, the talents, the gifts that God had given her that she then bestowed on all of us. Amen. It's good to recall those things and remember.
Amen. Amen. By the way, we're glad to see Glenn this morning.
Yay.
Good to have you here, brother. Boy, does that take me back. I look over at him and...
Right,
14? Yeah.
Well,
11?
14.
11?
14? He's a wonderful brother. Served God in so many different ways. You know that Mom and Dad always enjoy having him. I'll pay a visit. And he's all grown up, as many of you are. Back and I see Dale, he's getting there quicker and quicker. We're glad to see him, and we're looking forward. I don't know if you've heard the news, but we're looking forward here in not too many days, maybe a couple, 2-3 weeks into March. We're going to be doing a baptism here, God willing. Not only Dale, I remember baptizing Dale when he was a baby, little guy. But he is now, he loves the Lord, and he now realizes he wants to do that by his own will, not mom and dad's will. So he wants to be baptized as a believer now, which is certainly something we do. And mom as well, Tiffany, would like to be baptized as
great.
Well. So that certainly is a praise this morning as we think of what's coming up in the near future. Mm-hmm. I know there's other praises here. Who else can share? Anybody? Okay, let's pray. And as I explained, I'll open in prayer, and then I'll be silent and allow you to pray either in your heart silently for what God is put there to pray for, or if you want to pray out loud, we'd be glad to have you do that. And when the sanctuary grows quiet, then I will close in prayer. Let's go before the Lord. Our Father, Almighty God, thank you for every opportunity that you give us, whether it's here on a Sunday morning on a beautiful sunlit day, or whether it's the opportunity that you give us in the quietness of the night, in the midnight hours, where everything is silent. You've told us to come to you in prayer continuously, wherever we are, whatever the hour, whatever the need. You love us and you're ready to answer the prayer. Your word does say that you are able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or think. You answer our prayers in so many wonderful ways, and you remind us that you always hear us and you're always there. This morning we want to pray for Pastor Andrew and the family, as they're dealing with some health issues, and I'm sure they're thinking of us this hour just as much as we're thinking of them. So bless them and heal them. Bring them back to the fullness of health. Bring them back to the church in not many days, and we'll thank you for that. We also want to lift up prayers in the sanctuary personally, individually, as you direct us by your Holy Spirit. So, Father, we come to you now as a congregation, as a family of God in this place, and we pray that you would hear our prayers and answer our prayers according to your will. And we pray right now.
Father, thank you for this opportunity to walk boldly and confidently into your presence. I and your whole church need you.
Yes.
We are incapable of doing anything without you, anything correct, anything according to your will. We will go astray. I will lead other people astray if you don't constantly bring to mind your word to my heart. Use it as a guardrail to keep me in the path that you have chosen for me. Use it as a rule book to keep me in the company that I need to be in. And use your Holy Spirit to guide me what I say, what I do, and what I think. Help me not to think about things that are inferior, things that are not worthy of you. Help me to turn away from them and turn to you. God, we come to you singly and we come to you as a group. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Father God, I do ask your blessing on my daughter-in-law, who's just been diagnosed with cancer, that you will be with her Monday as she starts her treatment. doctor describes as fully treatable and comfort the family. Take away the apprehension, Father God. Be with my son Bill as he goes for his MRI on the 1st. Preparing for surgery, Lord, you know. You've already got your hand on the whole situation. We praise you for it. You're so good, God. Thank you. Thank you so very much.
Good morning, God.
Good morning, Jesus.
Thank you for this day and for your love and grace. I come to you in prayer for safe travel for Todd and Tara as he takes her home and returns back again today. Continue prayer for healing for Sandra. She's recovering from surgery, and prayer for both her and Todd as they continue to navigate this time. Prayer for Joe. And prayer for my boss, Valerie's mom, who has been diagnosed with a tumor in her stomach that is inoperable. I pray for Valerie and her family for strength in this time as they decide what is best and what is good for her. Thank you, Father, for hearing my prayers today. I love you, Father. I love you, Jesus. In your son's holy name I pray. Amen.
Father God, I lift up Robin. She's facing health issues that we don't seem to have an answer for. Mm-hmm. We're going to continue to look, Father God, and ask you to be with her for her tests on Friday and just cover her with your love.
Father God, thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for even hearing the words. doors of our hearts when sometimes it's too difficult to speak. Lord God, we know the circumstance in the world today. On a daily basis, we see the hatred and the division, not just among the nations, but within families. Lord, thank you for hearing the prayers of our heart when we pray for the circumstances that surround us. When we pray for love to be our theme and not hatred. This morning, Lord, we know that you're here with us. We know that you heard every word. And now, Lord, according to your mercy and your grace and your great love for your church, answer these prayers. Give us a testimony in days to come about your faithfulness. We thank you, Lord, and we love you. Bless us now. Bless our brother Bob as he brings the message this morning. And bless every heart in this place abundantly, beyond measure, as only you can do. We pray these things and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 My name is Bob Hampson. I'm a trustee here at the church. My wife, son, and I have attended here for about 20 years. Thanks to at that time it was Pastor Herney and Vic Lewis and Rory Williams who introduced us to Mallory Church. Pastor's father, Pastor Greg's father, was here. Gene Stein, he was also a trustee. So those are my credentials. You know, you would talk to Pastor Greg, you would say, is the Dr. Luke of pastors. I'm more like one of those fishermen that Jesus picked up. But I hope that the message today edifies you in the church. God uses all of us. He uses each one of you, hopefully daily in your daily lives. But please, if you ever have the urge, as Jeanette did her 5 minutes between worship, bring it forth. Come on up here and share it with us. So I just want to say good morning.
Good morning.
It's a beautiful day out there. It looks cold. It is cold, but it doesn't feel so cold today as it did yesterday. Glenn, why don't you come up here for a second? I just want to do a short demonstration. Okay, so did you ever do those trust exercises? You can stand down there, please. Did you ever do those trust exercises? Maybe you work for a company that, you know, you would do those kinds of things. I should turn just to the right a bit, kind of face me. One of the things would be is a trust exercise, which is Glenn, fall backwards and I'll catch you.
Okay.
Go ahead. Well, I don't understand.
You want me to fall backwards that way?
So remember that little thing. Before I get started, I'd like to mention that there was a movie that my wife and I saw at the recommendation of Pastor Andrew Federico.
It's called Time Changer.
It's a great movie. It really is. It's a lot of fun to watch. It gives you a lot of insight, and it sticks with you afterward. So it's a good, wholesome movie, and it's about the times we're in today, and about the times back in the 1800s, and how different that might be. So give it a shot if you're feeling like you want to watch something worthwhile. Today, I'll start off with a scripture. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ our Lord. John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn it, but to save the world through him. So I want to say, Lord, I thank you for your obedience to the Father, taking our sin, substituting yourself for us, receiving the penalty of death for our sin upon your body, so that we may live and have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor Greg likes to title his sermons, and I kind of like that too. So the title of today's sermon is No Way, Yaweh. So just remember that. When you're in a situation, you say, there's no way, just think Yahweh. I'll read a little bit from Exodus. I'm reading a book. It's called The Red Sea Rules. And it just explains the Exodus and what that may mean. But anyway, we're not going to focus solely on that. But it is the Easter season, so it will involve death and resurrection. So there was the Exodus. Pharaoh was finally convinced to let Israel go. And at that time, it's estimated that there were 2 million Israelites. And it goes like this in 14:10. And remember, Pharaoh thought of himself as a god. So as Pharaoh approached, Israel has exited. They're on their way. They're being led by the pillar of smoke and the pillar of fire. So as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up and saw the Egyptians marching after them. And they were terrified and cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us into the wilderness to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Did we not say to you, Egypt, leave us alone so that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. But Moses told the people, do not be afraid, stand firm, and you will see the Lord's salvation,
Amen.
Which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. And the angel of God, who had gone before the camp of Israel, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from before them and stood behind them, so that it came between the camps of Egypt and Israel. The cloud was there in the darkness, but it lit up the night, so that all night long neither camp went near the other. It kind of sounds like Satan who believes he's God. And God brings us to a dead end. There's no hope there. The Israelites here feared for their lives, obviously. They wanted to go back to Egypt. They said, why did you even bring us here? They knew that they were in a bad spot, that it was a fatal place to be. They were hemmed in by on all sides, and in front of them was the Red Sea. There was no way out. But there was Yaweh. He intervened, holding the evil back, opening the Red Sea, seeing his people safely to the other side, seeing us safely to the other side, and defeating the false god of Pharaoh and his armies who would have destroyed God's people. We have many Red Sea events in our lives. When we were at our end, but suddenly and faithfully, God intervenes. He wants to demonstrate his power for his glory.
Amen.
And gain our praise of appreciation. He did a great thing at the Red Sea. Not only did he bring his people safely to the other side, but he destroyed the enemy that was after them.
That's right.
So he accomplished two things at that dead end. Sometimes we wonder why God would bring us to such a place, because he in fact did lead them there. Mm-hmm. One of the greatest Red Sea events we'll face is our transition from this life to the next. And as my wife had mentioned, we were at a funeral recently, and we had Rory's funeral here, so people passing on have been at the forefront of our lives here for the past couple of months. But typically, I find that people don't fear death on a daily basis. I mean, otherwise we'd all be running amok. We'd be a little bit out of our minds. Until we face death. And then somehow, I was talking to a man at the funeral, and we were discussing it, and somehow when you're at that moment, it is a surprise. It's like, how did I get here? It's almost like it happens to somebody else, not to me. This attitude might be explained in the following scripture. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, the title is God Set Eternity in the Heart of Mankind. He has made everything appropriate in its time. He has also set eternity in their heart, without the possibility that mankind will find out the work which God has done from the beginning even to the end. So we're kept in the dark about that. But still, we have eternity in our hearts. And although I was born in 1957, I'm not distressed that I have no personal memories before that, prior to being born. I've never sensed non-existence. Perhaps it's history. Perhaps history has given me place before being born that I do not, but there is a place prior to history that I don't know. You can think back and back and back and say, you know, if you want to consider the dinosaurs, and then what about before then, and then all of a sudden you're in a place where there's no knowledge, there's no imagination, you can't really know what it was. But I think that is because, and I understand someday I will die, but I don't really believe it. And I think it is because God set eternity in our hearts. But despite not believing it, I know it will happen. And I do. do fear that moment. The Bible says in Hebrews 9:27, and it is appointed unto men to once to die, and after this the judgment. We like to say in life that there are two things that are certain, and that's death and taxes. Funny though, that taxes continue on after our deaths. There's death taxes that have to be paid, inheritance tax, estate tax. But life continues too.
Amen.
Remember, he placed eternity in our hearts and promised to take us to where he is.
Amen.
Both the apostles, John and Paul, went to heaven. They saw it. And thanks to Jesus, we will too. How is it that we avoid this death penalty? It's faith in Jesus. John 14:5-6. Jesus is the way. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way. I'm the truth, and I'm the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Amen.
Jesus became the truth, the way, and the life for us when he paid our penalty for our sins. All of our sins, for all of us. You can probably think of some pretty heinous, evil deeds that have been done in the world and think, how could Jesus possibly forgive those? Well, he didn't forgive them. He took them to the cross, and they were killed. He died as sin. And all you have to do is to accept what Jesus did. Jesus took my penalty. He died not only for me, but because of me. Who do you think placed the nails in his hands? Who do you think swung the hammer? He died for you too. It was not easy for Jesus to die. We insult him by trying to be our own saviors, creating our own morality, each one going his own way, a sign of the last days, the end times, which I believe we're in. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he asked the Father 3 times if there was any other way. He was distressed. He sweat blood. Is there any way to take this cup away from me? The Bible says there's no other name under heaven to be saved by which you can be saved. Jesus came to save the world, not to condemn it. Let's visit Jesus in the garden that night. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, sit here while I go there and pray. He took Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee along with him. He began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here. Watch with me. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. He was asking, is it possible, if not to go to the cross, not to die? Then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. Could you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away a 2nd time and prayed, my Father, if
if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. Amen. Then he came back. He again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Rise, let us go. Jesus resolved in the garden, made the decision to follow God's will and go to the cross. The decision was made in the garden. His struggle was over. Jesus was resolved. But you see, when Jesus came to earth, it was a one-way ticket. Jesus came to earth to die for our sins. And as we just saw, it's a struggle for anybody to do that. But he's God. He had everything. And this meant he would have nothing. And being found in an appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. It's Philippians 2:8. And Jesus was raised on the third day, but how? He was born a helpless baby, but he would also be helpless in death. Thus, in Luke 23:46, Jesus called out with a loud voice as he's on the cross, about to die. Calls out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. Jesus died, but he trusted God to raise him up. He trusted God. He commended his spirit to the Father, and he trusted God. Now, in our short demonstration earlier, my son came up, and I asked him to trust me. I said, "Fall backward, and I'll catch you." Of course, he looked behind him, and he said, "Hey, no, I don't think so." But Jesus trusted God. Jesus trusted God to raise him up. It's hard to trust anybody for anything. Even if I was standing behind Glenn, I think Glenn probably would have looked a few times just to be sure, and maybe a little hesitant to fall backward, but I think he would have trusted me in the end. I don't know. I know there's a couple of you in here that wouldn't have trusted me at all. No, thank you. But Jesus, how wonderful he trusted God. He was obedient to him. He believed him. He trusted him. "Into your hands I commend my spirit." So, God made it a round trip. It wasn't a one-way trip. But the torment that Jesus felt, it's like that song, "I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin on that cross." But Romans tells us in 10:13, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." The love of God is trustworthy. It's the same way with the resurrection of the dead. Our earthly bodies, this is Corinthians 15:42. Our earthly bodies will be planted in the ground when we die. But they will be raised to live forever. Our bodies are buried in brokenness, but they will be raised in glory. They are buried in weakness, but will be raised in strength. They are buried as a natural human body, but they will be raised as spiritual bodies. For just as there are natural bodies, there are also spiritual bodies. The scripture tells us the first man, Adam, became a living person, but the last Adam, that is Christ, is a living, life-giving spirit. What comes first is the natural body. Then the spiritual body comes later. Adam, the first man, was made from dust and of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. Earthly people are like the earthly man, and heavenly people are like the heavenly man. Just as we are now like the earthly man, we will someday be like the heavenly man. We will be like Christ. So do not be deceived. In Acts 4:12-13, it says, salvation is found in no one else. We just heard Christ ask God if there was any other way. Didn't just ask him once, he asked him three times. There's no other way. For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved.
Amen.
The Apostle Paul did not fear death. In fact, he preferred it. He said, I think he preferred life to life, really. He said in Philippians 1:21, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in this body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. So, is it a life to death ending for us, or a life to life? Remember, Paul visited heaven. No wonder he desired to be there. So wherever you are in life at this point, do not be like Lot's wife. Jesus told his disciples toward the end to remember Lot's wife. They were leaving Sodom. God was to destroy it. Lot's wife and Lot and his family were leaving the town. It was destroyed. Lot's wife turned around, looked, and was being turned into a pillar of salt, despite God's command not to look back. She was among believers. She was related to Abraham. She heard, attended all the religious traditions of the day, came to church, heard the teachings, and yet she really wasn't truly saved. The last scripture is washed. It's called washed. I call it washed. John 13. Jesus is washing the feet of the disciples. So he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, you do not realize what I'm doing, but later you'll understand. No, Peter said, you shall never wash my feet. And then Jesus admonished him and said, unless I wash you, you have no part in me. Hmm. We talk about being washed in the blood of Christ. He went to the cross for us. And if we are not washed, we have no part in him. We'll miss our opportunity for eternity with him. And if you have not made that decision to accept Jesus' atonement for our sins so that we can be reconciled with God the Father and spend eternity with him, make that decision now. Make it in your heart. You will have Red Sea moments. You will be trapped. You will have no escape. And you will find that there is no way out. Surely, even at the point of our deaths, you'll say, no way. But of course there is. Thanks to Jesus. Mm-hmm. Yahweh.
That's right. Yahweh.
thank you. It is your will that none would be lost. Lord, let us take this message today and to our hearts. Let us meditate upon it, and more so, let us act upon it. We thank you, Lord, for